Good afternoon. Thanks for joining us here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm Keely Boltina. You've already heard from the Democrat and Republican leaders already, and Governor Dennis Dugard is set to talk to us in just about 50 minutes for his end-of-the-week press conference this final week of the 2011 legislative session. First, joining me now is the Department of Public Safety Secretary Trevor Jones. So thank you, Secretary Jones, for making time for us today.
Thank you for having me.
Let's talk flooding today. Let's start with kind of an overall picture maybe of the flooding outlook for South Dakota right now.
Okay. One thing you should probably do is go back to last year, if you can recall that in 2010 we had major flooding issues in that northeast part, and then we really didn't get a break because when the fall came around, the rains came, and then right after the rains, the snow came. And usually somewhere along there get a little break in there, but the moisture just kept coming and coming, and of course now we've seen some record snowfall in areas of South Dakota. That's built on top of the moisture content that's already in the soil, and so the soil saturated, plus you have now all the snow sitting on top, which obviously has to go somewhere once the temperatures warm up, which they are starting to do, and then of course also our spring brings rain, which is going to also add to that moisture that's going to be flowing with the melted snow.
So are there areas of South Dakota that are going to be bracing, I think the governor has said, for record flooding, and if so, where are those?
You're primarily looking into the northeastern part of South Dakota and then down in the Sioux Falls area, just along the Jim River and the Big Sioux River is primarily one of where your focus should be if you're looking for flooding and concerned about flooding. Right now, that's where it looks to be.
And it seems like that was probably some of the hardest hit areas last year as well. So could you maybe just talk about how we're coming off of last year with things like roads are still, you know, broken up, homes were destroyed last year because of the record flooding. What are those people looking at now? Are we looking at the same thing?
You're looking at the same thing and maybe even a little bit more, just based on, as I said, the soil content's already saturated. Again, you got from last year still, and then you got all the snow sitting on top of it. So yeah, those homeowners, businesses, areas that were of concern last year, they're again of some major concern this year, just because the water is still there and more water is going to be added to it.
Sure. Spring and summer of 2010 were pretty significant for the Department of Public Safety and dealing with that flooding. So how did the department handle all of that? What do you have in place to work with the flooding?
Well, very similar to our plans of last year. And you know, we always try and refine them year by year by year. And last year, just like this year, we're working with our local partners in the counties and in the cities with their emergency managers to make sure they are prepared. Also help the citizens be prepared as well so they can take care of their residences, and we can, as the state, work with them hand in hand and get assets in place so when the flooding does occur, because we know it's going to occur, we just don't know exactly how much. We know it's coming, but we want to make sure we have assets in place to assist our local partners in the counties.
So what kind of things can the state government do to help people when the floodwaters are rising?
Well, primarily what the state and the federal government does, we bring resources that might not be readily available to the counties or cities. And whether you're talking sandbags, manpower, heavy machinery, those sorts of things, if those are needed and aren't available in the local level, we can bring those resources to bear on the problem, on the issues of the flooding in that area.
Okay, and those aren't, you've mentioned those assets, but things like that aren't free or cheap by any means. So where does the funding come from to handle these flooding problems?
Most of your, all levels of government, primarily your federal government obviously has a response plan that they provide local or dollars to help the states with their flooding issues, along with any natural disaster issue. Flooding would just be one of them. So yeah, those resources come from all levels of government and are provided sometimes through the taxpayer dollar. Sometimes they do cost the homeowner some money, but most of the time those, when we're protecting infrastructure, that's your government dollars at work.
When Governor Dugard was talking about flooding, he said that there are when he was talking about taxes, he says that he would probably only be able to raise taxes in the event of a catastrophic event. Do you think that any of the flooding that we're going to see would bring you to that point where you have to have a conversation with the governor that this is a catastrophe, especially considering we had so many, it was a record number of declared emergencies last year because of flooding, right?
Correct.
So is that something that you'll have to talk with the governor with? Have you been working with him for flood plans? How is that all happening within government?
Well, the point of clarification on the record number of declarations does involve snowfall too, you know, your ice storms and those sorts. So it's not of those seven declarations, there weren't all due to flooding. they were due to some winter issues as well, and also obviously your tornado, what have you. So flooding is a major issue. As far as your catastrophic, how do you know? I guess we don't know. That conversation may be taking place down the road. Only the future knows, based on, or only we know based on what we see in the future of rainfall, how rapidly the snow will melt, those sorts of things, other factors that come into play that are hard to predict, but we try to prepare for.
And how are you able to step back and not just say, well, this area flooded last year, so it'll probably flood again? What are the tools that you have to establish what you can kind of expect for the flooding?
We work hand in hand with the National Weather Service, and we also work with the Corps of Engineers, and we work with FEMA, and then we work with the local officials as well to determine, obviously, we want to look at the weather outlook for the next 30 days, the precip outlook for the next 30 days, the hydrologists at the National Weather Service, that's who helps us determine soil content, moisture content in the soil, so we can determine how much runoff we might have. And we utilize their numbers to help us prepare and place assets in and around the state. Primarily our concern now is, like I said, the northeast part of South Dakota.
So this is more of a step-by-step as time goes, as you see how fast it's melting, as you see how much rainfall, we can kind of reassess throughout the year. I know last year it went even into September, we were seeing places flood.
That's correct. And that's, we remember we had those fall rain showers as well that didn't help us at all with that. And so again, we didn't get that break that we kind of like. It was always moisture on top of moisture on top of moisture, and we're going to deal with that here and now. So as far as we look at those, the outlook that are provided us to by those organizations, and obviously they deal with, the Corps of Engineers deals with it through other parts of the nation, so they have gauges, etc., that monitor the rivers and the lake levels, so they help us to determine, okay, where's the moisture at, where's the likely, most likely place of flooding, let's get our assets in place there so we can deal with the flooding issues that we know are going to come, but just how severe they're going to be, we don't know yet.
Sure. Now, how much of the flooding outlook for 2011 is actually due to some of the moisture that was left in the ground from last year's flooding, and how much is really just because we're still getting large amounts of snow and different predictions like that?
That one would be tough to say. I mean, it's hard to say. I mean, we could probably track how much moisture we've got month by month by month and might be a better idea, but I couldn't tell you right now. I just know the soil, based on what we've seen through the hydrologist report, is very saturated. And we know there's a lot of moisture left out there because we can see the snow and we know the rains are coming.
Okay, what can people do to prepare as the state is you know, gearing up for some of this major record flooding? How can people prepare themselves for it?
One thing they can do is obviously inform themselves. One best way you can do that is obviously listen to the news, monitor your weather forecasts that are going to be coming out. Go to the website. BeReadySD.com. There on there are some points and information of how you can, obviously, flood insurance is very important, and you can get information regarding how to acquire flood insurance. There's a certain time frame prior to the flooding that you have to purchase your flood insurance. You can do things to your house, etc., unplug appliances. If there is a flood warning, that means a flood has occurred. You should be prepared to get to higher ground if necessary if you live in that area. Obviously have a plan for evacuation, maybe a kit to take with you as well, whether it's, and even have an evacuation kit at home, so you have those things readily available, whether you're going to stay there, if the power should go out, or if you have to leave, you can take the kit with you as well, and notify your neighbors what you're going to do as well, so they aren't looking for you in your flooded home because you've already left it and went to higher ground, safer place.
So some of those basic safety precautions are the things that people should keep in mind.
Very much communicate with your neighbors and obviously listen to any, or gather as much information you can on the weather that's coming in.
As we go into this, is the state prepared for what you expect at this point? You know, is everything ready and in place to make things happen when people need help?
We're working towards that, to that point. I wouldn't say we're there right now. We're continually monitoring those reports that come through the National Weather Service and trying to get our pieces in place, so if it looks at the outlook is in place as they say it is, this 20%, 30% chance or whatever it is, we try to work with those figures and do our best we can, but nothing is for certain until we get to that point.
Sure. Is there anything else that people should understand about the way DPS addresses flooding and how they should be prepared?
Well, I think one of the primary things they should always be look to is look to their local officials, because the local officials know their area, better than we do. We're there to assist the locals. So as far as assets, the sandbags, shelters, resources that the citizen may need, look to your local official first, and we'll work with those local officials to make sure they have enough there to supply them to the citizenry if that should be necessary.
Good advice. Thank you very much, Mr. Secretary. You've been listening to a live interview with the Secretary of the Department of Public Safety, Trevor Jones. I'm Keely Boltina for SDPB. Thanks for joining us here on SDPB 2, and the Governor's Press Conference will be up at 3 o'clock.